Good morning. This is the August 4th meeting of the ReUse Committee. And we should get started because we have a lot to talk about. Has everyone had a chance to look at the minutes from July 14th?
I have copies here. Mm-hmm. Somebody would like a copy?
John, did you happen to see them? Did you write them?
I did.
On the bicart.
You want to take a moment to read them, Debbie?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
maybe while Debbie reads that, we should just move to the next agenda item and come back to approve the minutes. The committee administrative change, and this is about the fact that we have been a subcommittee of the Public Works Commission, which no longer exists or is about to no longer exist.
I think it no longer exists, but I'm not certain.
Okay, David, does it exist anymore at the Public Works Commission?
Intentionally, no. But just whether the paperwork has been done to abolish
it,
I don't know.
Okay, so we need a new home as part of the city government. And so the question, as I understand it, is are we going to report to, is it Central Services? Directly to the mayor.
The point is
the options.
The options, right? So he wants to codify. He wants to make sure that we have a home. The mayor does. If you go to his administrative code that was approved in September of 2014, and you all have access to it through the web. There is, it kind of lays out, there are two parts to it, and the second part is laying out the committee structure. And you'll see that it needs to be updated because of some of the changes that have occurred, including the Board of the Public Works Commission change. But he would like to have us have a permanent home. And so the question is, there's kind of a two-pronged question. One is, what is the best solution for us given the municipal structure that exists that we want to maintain? And second is, our charge has been focused on reuse, but we've also been focused on composting and recycling to a certain extent. Do we want to formalize that by having a name change potentially of the committee and maybe being more of a waste reduction type committee with an emphasis on reuse and composting or whatever. So those are the two pieces. What our overall charge is, and does it need to be changed? And then what structure makes sense for us?
Right.
I can't guarantee that what we propose is going to happen, but he wants to hear what we have to say.
Okay.
So if you go to the administrative code, there are, I was hoping to get a printout of it, but we have some printer challenges, and I hopefully Deb will be bringing in a copy of it shortly. But on page 13, they have office and standards is the part two, and it talks about multiple member bodies. And essentially, we would have to follow some of the rules that the Public Works Commission followed. So they aren't onerous. It's the same kind of stuff that my committee in Amherst did. A lot of it we already do. One is that, so there are a couple changes. One would be that the people would be appointed by the mayor, and in order to get appointed, and again, this is how it's done in Amherst, in order to get appointed, you fill out a form, an interest form online, and you would meet with the mayor, and the mayor would appoint you, and then you get kind of sworn in as an appointed member. The key change would be that typically people have terms, And again, this is what we had in Amherst. It's usually terms of 3 years, but you can be reappointed. As you know from the Public Works Commission, people can be reappointed ad nauseum. There's to my knowledge, no, I don't, ad nauseum is not the right word.
No, that's
you know
not
what
right
I mean.
In gratuity.
Thank you. sorry about
check
that.
Check your
life. but so that would be, there's a term of office, and usually with these committees, you try to appoint people in stages so that not everybody leaves in 3 years, or not everyone has the choice to leave in 3 years. And usually those terms are effective in July 1st, and then they expire in June. There's the oath of office. The meetings are supposed to be held regularly, and it says, at times and places that the body, which would mean our committee, their own rules shall prescribe. So we would decide when we would meet. I don't see any information about the necessity to meet during after working hours, for instance, which is one of our questions. Mm-hmm. I don't see that that's a need, at least from this administrative code, and that would. I will investigate that further with the city clerk, but I don't think that that's an issue. Special meetings can be called by the chair or a majority of members of the body. It needs to be posted in accordance with open meeting law. And all meetings are open to the public and have an opportunity for the public to offer comment. So a lot of this stuff we've already been doing. Meeting documents, rules, and regulations. We can determine own rules and order of business. Agenda, minutes, and related submissions are a public record. Again, not a big change. A quorum must be established, and we can't meet in the absence of a quorum. They also have approved remote participation as an option, which means that somebody could participate via conference call or even Skyping. So that's some municipalities don't allow that, but evidently Northampton does. Internal organization, we would need a chair, a vice chair, and a clerk, and others necessary or required by law, but I think that we would be fine with that. We have the authorization to establish subcommittees by a majority vote of membership, and that would be for the purpose of addressing a particular issue or issues. And they are required to observe laws relevant to keeping public record, open meeting law, and any other blah, da, 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 da. So it's what we had talked about was that the reuse committee would then establish a subcommittee for the reuse center, for the recenter. As far as the one thing that caught my eye, excuse me, that I was concerned about was the requirement of residency. And technically it says that all members must be residents of the city during their term of office. Okay. And we have at least one person on our committee that does not reside in the city of Northampton. I don't know how much that is.
Hey,
welcome. Everyone knows
Anna.
Hi. So I don't know how much that is enforced. I don't know if that's a big issue or not. So that we could certainly look into that. That's something that we need to look at.
Yeah.
And then finally, authority. We would be an advisory committee, which means technically, according to the document, we would have no legal authority to promulgate rules or regulations. Or decide individual cases, but that has essentially been the case. That's not a change. It's not like we're the public works, the Board of Public Works that could actually set rates and do some of those things. We've always been in an advisory capacity.
To who?
Advisory to me and to the Department of Public Works.
Okay, not to the mayor.
And so that's one of the questions that Diana had collected, that's one that that is still a little unclear to me,
okay,
that I will clarify. But I believe, you know, it's advisory to the board, the DPW, I believe, and I will confirm that.
So, just to clarify,
mm-hmm,
again, like other commissions, like the Public Shade Commission or whatever,
mm-hmm,
it is,
mm-hmm,
the Shade Tree Commission, would this potential group overall be, in the architecture of the city, a advisory group to the city council, the mayor, to the DPW, or, I mean, is there a...
Yeah, that's what I need
it's
clarification
still not clear
on. It's my understanding it would be to me and the DPW, or to the DPW, but I need to clarify that.
So just for the analogy of the Shade Tree Commission, who do they report to, for example? To an individual or to...
Oh, well, the Shade Tree Commission is an advisory to the DPW and Rich Parcelletti, who is the highway
warden.
Superintendent, but he's also the tree warden. Isn't he the highway
superintendent?
Yeah. He's the highway superintendent and the tree warden. Oh. So they're an advisory committee to him.
So how just because I don't quite understand the politics of
mm-hmm
that much.
And neither do I.
I understand.
I'm
it's a little confusing.
Uh-huh.
So the city council, how do they, I mean, I see the mayor and the city council, they have overarching
jurisdiction
mm-hmm over all these other committees, for example. Is that correct? Or would they say, you know, if they had an issue with whatever this committee was recommending,
uh-huh,
would they go to the DPW and then the DPW would come back to us, or would they have a direct connection with the committee in some way, shape, or fashion?
I come from town
yeah,
meeting,
yeah.
So I'm still, I don't
well,
consider
no
myself an expert in
right
this,
does
so
anybody
I
understand
hesitate
the politics of that? Or?
So you know that the mayor is no longer in the restructuring of our government involved with the city council. So we have a separation of basically legislative and executive
okay
functions.
Okay.
So the mayor is in charge of the school committee, but no longer sits on the city council.
Oh, I didn't quite understand that.
So you have 9 representatives in the city council. The city council presents a budget to the mayor, and the mayor has veto power over, I don't know if it's the whole budget or items in the budget, but that's how it works.
So, David, they propose the budget.
That's
the
correct.
The city council does, not the mayor.
That's correct.
No, the mayor proposes the budget.
The mayor proposes the budget to the city council?
The city council votes on it.
Right.
Okay.
So, we clearly have a question about residency. We have a question about reporting structure. And one of the other questions that Diana had compiled.
I was just compiling everybody's
yes
input. It wasn't mine.
Is the parameters which decisions can be made as committee. It's an advisory committee, but certainly within your charge, we will have decision-making authority. It's just not, we're not going to be able to set financial, you know, rates, you know, for the transfer station or something like that.
But it also affects how we spend our revolving fund and whatever else. Well, that goes to a different jurisdiction.
Well, we also, right, but Ned always had veto power, and I have some veto power as well. So it's not that much of a change from, potentially, from what we've had in the past. We just need to understand the reporting structure, and I will confirm that.
Yeah, and when we have a letter to write, who are we writing to? I guess it's another question that's sort of practical.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. And then another question that Diana had compiled was access to city funds. And I don't think that would change from what we have now. Again, the reporting structure is something that we need clarification on. Diana's other questions were, how will committee members be appointed? We got that figured out. How will the recenter working group be affected? That would be a subcommittee.
Mm-hmm.
And meeting times, as far as I know, we would not have to meet after working hours. So any other concerns or questions that you guys would have that I can research?
Is there a timeline for from the mayor for all this?
Typically this, the what do they call it, the administrative charter changes, I think, happen in the fall. So it's not, we need to do something soon so that the mayor has something by, you know, September. I don't know when in September, but soon.
David, you made a comment at the last meeting, which I didn't, you didn't have time to clarify, about the structuring of the name and the group we would work with. There was another group in the city.
There is the sustainability office, which is part of central services in Northampton. It historically, it was unclear to me exactly how solid waste wasn't a part of the sustainability office in Northampton. Chris Mason, who's terrific, who was one of the co-founders of Green Northampton with me, is the sustainability officer in Northampton. It's a route for us to consider. I haven't spoken to Chris about it. I don't know what it would take.
What does the sustainability office do?
Well, his main function has been making the city more efficient, working on energy efficiency for all city buildings, getting the solar panel array built out of the landfill, which is being installed this fall. So it's really been about getting the city more sustainable.
It's associated with bikes too, like
well,
pedestrian
there's a,
traffic and bicycles.
I don't know, because there's a transportation and parking commission that does not fall under his purview. So
that meeting that we went to, that you and I went to at the senior center about planning, and I think that was related, or was that
it was stormwater and. Yeah, I'm not sure. I feel like there's an overlap, and I'm not sure where it is.
Is there a point to having one larger group that does all that stuff, or is it better to have separate, smaller focused groups?
You talking about in terms of city structure?
Yeah.
Because Wayne is city planning, and Chris is sustainability, and somebody else is transportation and parking.
And we're solid waste.
Yeah.
We're solid waste, which at one time came under the Board of Health until about 20 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, and then it got transferred to the DPW.
Have you spoken to Donna on this question?
Donna.
Saloon.
About
the
what,
DPW
where
director.
We,
yeah.
Well, I
right,
she has spoken to the mayor about it. I mean, this is something that was prompted by some of the changes that are happening at DPW. So I haven't spoken to her recently about it.
Well, I think that would be also very important. Mm-hmm. Perhaps more important than a lot of other questions.
Mm-hmm. Can you flesh that out a bit more, David? What would we specifically ask her?
If she is happy with the present administrative setup, where our connection to the city is through the DPW, and you know, so she's in the picture. The DPW is the facilities
right.
are all owned and operated by the.
We're on her plate, but does she want it?
Yeah. Right.
There are a few. Just to give a sense of perspective, I meet quarterly with municipal recycling coordinators from all over the region, and it's typically they either are within the DPW, Public Works, or a few of them are still in the health department, especially for small towns. I've never heard of them being part of the planning department, for instance. It doesn't mean that it can't happen, but a lot of grants and a lot of resources are kind of tend to be funneled through the public works arena. So I don't know how that would be affected if a change like that were to be made. I know that Donna is extremely supportive of what we're doing and what we've achieved, and I think that it's a And it's a point of pride for the Department of Public Works, some of the stuff that we've achieved.
Right.
So I don't think that, I think that they would not necessarily be supportive of us leaving, but I don't know, that's assuming.
That's an important conversation.
My question.
And I don't know that it's even possible or that, you know.
My question is about the budgeting process. I assume if we're gonna be more formally folded into the city government with fewer layers, that we would need to present an annual budget at a certain time of year that would get approved, because it's been somewhat ad hoc up to this point.
Yeah, I don't think that many of the committees and commissions that I looked at, they don't really have budgets. So I don't know that we're a different case because we do have the recenter. So I don't know whether that would be required or not, but I can certainly ask.
I had just one other comment about reuse and composting. I think that reuse is a fine umbrella term to use for what we do, and I feel like compost is reuse of food waste or food scraps or you know, all organic matter. I don't feel like there's a disconnect there.
I just want to make the point that, and Diane, I think you were part of the committee before we were reuse committee, right?
Mm-hmm.
We were the Solid Waste Education Action Committee.
Mm-hmm.
So our purview, as far as the Board of Public Works was concerned, was that we served only as an educational
entity
mm-hmm. for the rest of the city on anything that came under the purview of recycling, compost, and reuse. That changed.
We were an action committee, and then when you were appointed to the Solid Waste Action Committee Task Force, we became the Solid Waste Education Action
right.
Committee.
So, I think that, and this is a good point, I think, to segue into the second half mm-hmm. of this point, and that is, what should our charge be, you know, rather than it being handed to us by the
mm-hmm.
Board of Public Works, we have the opportunity now to really define what that is. And we were limited in our existence before by what that definition was by the Board of Public Works. So this is, I think, not a small thing to take the opportunity now to really define what we want to be going forward.
One of my personal passions is waste reduction. I think that I find it extremely frustrating that major corporations are very happily supporting recycling efforts, but are not interested in supporting reduction efforts. And that's really what has to happen. They, you know, they're happy to support recycling because then they can continue to produce and sell and without feel, you know, they can pretend to be green because they're supporting recycling. But I feel passionately that we don't have to be buying all this stuff, and
mm-hmm.
that we need to be able to repair and that if the grassroots effort can't change the tide, no one is going to, because it's really hard. I mean, the reuse convention in Boston, it's hard to find corporate sponsorship because people, the whole model in the United States is to buy, and not so much to repair and not so much to share. All those things can affect corporations' bottom lines. Whereas recycling, they can continue producing and it's not a problem. So I feel passionately that in order to make a change, it's hard, but in order to make a change, we need to help change the individual resident's mindset. And I think that we've started to do that. I think through the rallies that we have, through the recenter, that we're starting in a small way to change people's mindsets. And so to me, if, you know, this committee already does that, and to legitimize that a little bit more, that it's not just about reuse. And I'm not saying that we need a name change, but that maybe that we need to emphasize that it's not just about reuse, it's about it's about reduction. And that's my personal feeling, because I think that I just see so many resources being thrown at recycling, and there are costs of recycling, and the profits in recycling have been affected over the last few years with the lower petroleum prices, with China, and there's a lot of things that have been happening, and those industries that have been involved in waste are a little less enthusiastic about recycling. So what are we to do? You know, we're producing unheard of quantities of single-use items and plastics that are getting thrown away, and recycling is no longer, or hasn't been for some time, the profit-making entity that it once was. More and more plastic is being used. It used to be that aluminum and paper were the big money-making features of recycling, because there's just lots of money in recycled paper and lots of money in aluminum. And as you know, aluminum is getting used less and less in the beverage industry, although some beer companies are going back to aluminum. And papers, people are not buying newspapers as much and are getting them delivered. So the paper industry has been affected over the last few years, the reduction of paper. So municipalities bringing paper and aluminum to these organizations have been affected. So they're not making their money, making their cash cow lines of product have been affected. And so and plastics is very tied to oil prices. And when oil prices are low, then recycling plastic and all of the resources that go into that, costs that go into that, wane in need. So
Susan, from my perspective, we have an opportunity to be somewhat educational in naming ourselves. I mean, the city doesn't really have outreach for recycling and reuse other than what we do as a committee.
Well, Karen's position. So part of the thing is what we have to think about too is what has happened through just fate. You know, Karen left. I was not available to be full time. She didn't do a lot of outreach, for instance, to schools necessarily, but she did tons of outreach in other ways. And she was excellent with writing special grant proposals and doing some really groundbreaking things. So it's kind of, when I came on and I was only half time, I saw this body and the enthusiasm and talent that you guys have as a way to keep making progress with me only being part-time. And you have. I mean, you've kicked some tukus. But that doesn't mean that this structure is what needs to go or should be going forward. I would hope that there would be a full-time position like Karen's position. My vision would be to have a somebody who would be a waste reduction kind of education person instead of a recycling coordinator, a waste reduction coordinator. I've actually been calling myself that because when I was hired, Ned's like, well, what do you want to call yourself? And I said recycling coordinator just because that's what my position has always been called. But I really feel like it's evolved to the point that it goes way beyond recycling. It has to. So if we have a full-time position, ostensibly that person can start doing more outreach to schools and more outreach in other ways. The whole repair piece, Roger is not here. He's had some work changes and his scheduling is a little difficult for Thursday mornings, but he's very passionate about repair. It's a big movement. I just posted something on Facebook yesterday, Pittsfield is having a reuse fair, I believe August 20th. Hmm. I will send that information out to you. And they've also announced several other dates that they're doing. that's a whole area that I really think would be phenomenal for this position and this organization, this committee to get involved with. So I kind of have this little fantasy vision of my position and this group promoting, yes, reuse, but also more composting awareness, more repair awareness, and yeah.
Okay, so let's hear questions and comments from other people that are on the committee.
Well, the wonderful world of RE, I think, has about 50 RE activities mm-hmm. that we could be involved with. I still see all of this approach, but we're doing, it's an expense approach as opposed to how can we actually focus on making money on this stuff, which is challenging when raw material prices go down. But just from the experience out there at Glendale, seeing how much, whether it's painted wood or wood that we can't accept for our recycling efforts, is still gonna have to be trucked great distances to be landfilled versus having a chipper, even if it's somebody who did come in once a month. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where the end use for that is yet, but there's a plant outside of Copenhagen, Denmark, where they're very fussy about their air and water, but they burn all kinds of garbage. So there must be somewhere in the United States that has one of these Danish plants, which if we ship by rail, simple, that is, and we're gonna have to ship the waste that we do generate is gonna have to go 5 hours to New York State, as I understand it, once Chicopee closes. So the expenses are actually only going to go up for waste. So by coming up with a more comprehensive plan, which I call CRAP, you know, creative recycling and production, do we break up glass and then ship it? Because that's a whole lot cheaper and actually make some money because we've identified markets, hopefully in conjunction with Smith College using their research and what you're doing right now, the whole look at the discard stream. So it's got to be a different approach than just some, this is an expense item for the city. You know, how we get to that, I'm not sure yet, but I think, first of all, having control over our own funding is to me very important. Have control over what we can spend. Not that we have to go for 3 months to try and get a check for something, because we've got to go through a bureaucratic structure. Now we can overlay something, I'll get to that when we come to the auction, which David and I talked about yesterday. We can overlay a methodology here, I'll get to that, which involves Green Northampton, so.
Okay, but at this point, Peter, it sounds like what you're saying is you would embrace anything that expands the purview of the reuse committee to include waste reduction.
All the way to Creativity Park.
Mm-hmm.
So I just need to emphasize that we are an advisory committee. So we can advise the DPW and it's our responsibility to be aware of options and opportunities. And we can then therefore advise the DPW and the mayor that this is where we think waste is going and this is what we think needs to happen. And that's the power that this committee has, and we have through influence and advisory capability, we have done a lot.
Can I just add one thing? David, you you pointed it out when the consideration of the new DPW director and what our role was gonna be, when that came about, you said, well, we're down here in importance, you know? So that really, it struck me, that's the best way of putting it. We're not that important to the DPW, I don't believe. I mean, it was something that was
I wouldn't necessarily.
Can I just say, we're putting the cart before the horse.
Right.
Really, what the agenda item is here is what do we want our purview to be? That's what we're trying to define.
Mm-hmm.
Not whether or not we're gonna be revenue generating or mm-hmm. who we're gonna report to. What is it that we would like? Do we want to continue to be a reuse committee, or do we want it to be something larger than that? That's the question.
And I just want to explain again our mission that we have already, that the Board of Public Works approved, and that we had approved about a year or so ago. And this is a little paraphrased. It says, the ReUse Committee promotes reuse, composting, and recycling in order to reduce the city's waste footprint or the amount of trash that's shipped outside of the city for disposal. Under the guiding principles of zero waste, the committee organizes volunteer-powered public waste reduction events and operates a permanent, self-sustaining recenter. As resources allow, the committee collaborates with community groups to promote other zero waste efforts. So that's a pretty good summation. Whatever we call ourselves, that mission I personally feel is a great mission. And a year ago we all thought it was a pretty good mission. So the question is, does that not capture what people feel this committee could or should be doing?
Does it say something about education? I'm thinking about what you said about the waste outreach, right?
Mm-hmm.
The waste
mm-hmm.
reduction, because
mm-hmm.
really this is Northampton and what we're doing, but waste reduction and the corporations who create stuff that's purchased and then needs to be, you know, eventually or possibly at the same time be thinking about the larger picture in the country or the world, let's say. And there probably are actions that are going on with corporations and
mm-hmm.
so.
It doesn't use the word education, but it does say committee promotes.
Yes, right.
Which is the general term.
Because the education part that I was thinking about when Susan was talking about waste reduction was that, you know, get it before it becomes trash that needs to be recycled. Because that's really, it's getting much, much closer to the root of the problem. The root is the production of this stuff.
Which we have no control over, but.
Well yes and no.
That's not really true.
No, right.
Extended producer responsibility.
That's
mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So I think that Debbie's right that there may be an added dimension to what's already written
mm-hmm.
that addresses
public education.
Not just public education, but the reduction of consumption as being part of the solution.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
yeah.
That's
I think it
says there. That it says under the guiding principles of zero waste,
which
we don't talk in those terms, but
mm-hmm.
that's essentially that you reduce all of you do whatever you can to reduce waste, and that means I'm sorry, I just lost
producer responsibility
yeah.
and grassroots movement
yeah.
building.
It means
and
all of
and
less consumption.
Right.
Yeah.
That means less consumption too. Yeah.
Just
yeah.
a quick read. If a television set was sold with a redeemer coin or whatever affixed to it, so somebody would pay the 25 and whatever it is. $25 disposal fee right when they're buying the TV set, and that, like, we affix
with
stickers.
The bottle bill.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The bottle bill. Okay.
Yeah.
So what? Oh, that would be.
I mean,
how
yeah,
you
that's
it?
That's a legislative
uh-huh.
way to go about
mm-hmm.
actually
mm-hmm.
getting something like that accomplished.
So I'm conscious of time. I'm going to look into these additional questions that we have about the structure. But I'd like just a sense of how people, you know, are you
sorry,
are people fairly content with the mission as it stands if we added in some educational emphasis and perhaps wordsmithed to make it clearer what zero waste means and the waste reduction aspect of that?
I would be as well, but I've always been resentful of the title of this committee. As being the reuse committee.
Mm-hmm.
That I felt has always fallen short of what our goals are. And as I say, it's an opportunity, this is an educational opportunity for us to make a statement to the community about what it is that we do. Because I think reuse is
so off the top
of
your head, David, what would you?
You know, solid waste reduction, maybe. I think that it needs to incorporate all of those things that you just talked about in that definition.
Mm-hmm.
It needs to talk about education. It needs to talk about solid waste reduction. I mean, but I'd like it to speak in a way that people understand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No waste living
for them? Whatever it is. Yeah. You know, I don't want it to talk to the industry. I want it to talk to the people in the city.
So David feels that the name doesn't quite represent what we do, and do other people agree? Do they disagree?
I feel flexible about that. I feel like we could put some effort into the branding process that we've been working on and make people understand what reuse means. Reuse doesn't just mean you fill up your water bottle again. It means all of what we talk about. It means the whole zero waste project. It means it means production responsibility. Producer responsibility,
mm-hmm.
is what I'm trying to say. It means composting.
It means promoting the ability to reuse.
Yeah, it means repair. It means all of those things that we actually do. And
mm-hmm.
I think making a long title is cumbersome. And so I would prefer to get people to think what reuse is really.
That's an interesting perspective, because there's also the concept of reusing, even recycling is reusing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Why not the Zero Waste Committee? Why not that? I mean, that covers everything.
Yeah, zero waste is a kind of a tough term. A lot of people don't get it, and they say, well, it's impossible to have zero waste. It's kind of a controversial term. The concept isn't so much controversial as those words, but most communities, so some communities are staying away from that term.
It also makes a political statement that we need to think about, you know, not everyone supports the idea of zero waste. It's logical as it may seem to us.
Right, but some cities are moving toward that. They are actually using that, and that would be the educational piece.
Yeah.
If you want. I mean, it's simple.
But it also could be part of the branding that to reuse means to reduce waste, because you're able to reuse and you know. So, you know, it doesn't sound like we're gonna be able to come to a complete agreement in the time we have left, and we have a bunch of other things to talk about. So I'm going to propose that we have a subgroup kind of meet. I will get a meeting and invite people to come and speak only of this, and we will get it sort of hashed out. Does that make sense to people?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll come up with something. I'll do a doodle, and we'll do it as soon as possible.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not in opposition to changing the name.
Okay.
So yeah, so we this group would look at the possibility of changing the name, and if we were to change our name, what it would be. Okay.
Okay. Going back to the July 14th minutes, do people have comments, edits, or additions? Or do I have a motion to approve as written?
Mm-hmm.
Second?
Second.
All right. Any blocking concerns? Everybody in favor?
Yes.
All right. Recenter report.
I guess I'll do that. We had a very busy weekend. Lots of help. Even Anna was out there. We appreciate it. And we moved a lot of heavy stuff, actually. Counted 50 different people taking things away, and there were probably at least 30 people that brought stuff that didn't take things away, so it was quite a busy morning.
Ping pong table and a desk.
Yep.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Did that oak desk go away?
That oak desk.
Yeah. Wow, great.
Yeah, so as I say, we had a lot of poundage, but I know there's a lot of poundage that went, metal stools and things like that. There was a group there yesterday, Diana and Andrea, and forget the other woman's name. A nice group of people out there.
Eileen,
cleaning up and getting ready for this weekend.
Thank you.
I think if you haven't seen the posting that Diana did, the city got out there and put up a beam to support the ceiling.
Did you see that?
Good picture.
Okay, good.
That was a good picture.
Yeah.
It really
it was so clear. Uh-huh. Told the whole story, no words.
So I don't know if you have a roof report that's going with that.
I called the roofer right away.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw that mm-hmm. Jonesy had completed, and I said that we're good to go and that we'd like to get something scheduled. Especially because I'm going to be out as of the 11th,
mm-hmm.
so I will follow up with him. But
okay.
I did.
So, any questions about doing fine that way?
Anything I should know about Saturday?
Unfortunately, it might rain.
Well, we have tents to.
Yeah, we have tents. Mm-hmm. And so, why
yeah. Oh, tents. Speaking of tents, at our working group meeting yesterday, there's some concerns. Continuing concerns about the tents not being secured,
yeah.
and
yeah.
that with wind sometimes,
sure.
several times.
I know.
So,
but
Peter,
we have weights there.
Yeah, we do have weights, but sometimes they don't work as well as we'd like them to. So
okay.
Peter suggested that we take some milk jugs and fill them with sand or water,
mm-hmm.
and then they can be tied to the bases
mm-hmm.
of the tents.
Okay.
He has some milk jugs.
And we're
going
to bring some out on Saturday.
Right.
At some point.
A gallon jug.
It's not
going to
be windy this Saturday. Won't be windy
it's
this
not
Saturday.
Be windy.
We have plenty of weights. The issue is making sure they're attached.
Right.
Well, but we'll have time to fill the jugs if you want to get them
the
to make Peter.
But the milk jugs is a good idea.
Right.
Easy.
I'll just have the volunteers fill
we'll
them.
Sand out.
And
there
are
is
they,
sand out there.
Yeah.
Are they actually attached or are they just placed on top?
No, they're
of
attached.
We
yeah,
have.
We've got
yeah.
we have weights on each leg. It's just whether or not they're
okay.
enough.
Okay.
Simplest ways with a shock cord
mm-hmm.
because it allows some flex.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The issue what happens is you get there in the morning, the air is perfectly still at 8 o'clock
right.
in the morning. So
right.
It's not until 10 o'clock the wind picks up and all of a sudden.
And it's busy. Of
course
you're
busy.
Busy. So you have to think ahead. It's
yeah.
not a windy day, but you know, it
mm-hmm.
could become warm. So.
Right.
Okay, should we talk about the 2015 report?
Yes, I would like to get that taken care of. I did not hear anything from anybody other than
the
one small change, I think from you, David.
The one question I had, Alan, about it was that you refer to the hundreds of pounds of things that were reused rather than thrown out. I'm just wondering, was that a modest choice of words as opposed to thousands of pounds during 2015 of the amount of waste that was diverted?
See, estimating the weight of steam and household objects, I got this from Susan, we estimate that during the 2015 season, 7.3 tons of material were reused and diverted from the landfill.
I think he's referring to this.
By the season closed in October,
third sentence
hundreds of items were taken home, hundreds of pounds of material
oh,
was
okay.
diverted.
We can change that.
That yeah, that was more just, a, you know, we couldn't say thousands of items were taken home.
No, but you could say
pounds.
Yeah.
Or many tons, you know, but the thing is hundreds of pounds fine. Sounds like, oh, where did they bother?
Yeah, many tons.
But other than that, I'm fully supportive of what's...
So the two comments I have still, one, I put in page 2, we estimated an average of 50 to 60 visitors visited each Saturday. I did that by this.
Mm-hmm.
We had no record from last year, but I did it from the two we have. And on page 3, the third bullet down says we
yes.
collect approximately X dollars from customer fishing to support. So
yeah, and I will fill that in. So I was thinking that I mean we're not gonna not approve it based on the number that
correct.
So I think that I mean I can get that number. We can approve it substantially
yeah.
and vote on it
mm-hmm.
so that we can just make these final changes that are not.
Are there other comments from anybody about this, Peter?
Well, I was just gonna suggest we could. Right at the very end, page 6, challenges under challenges and opportunities. In addition, we feel many people don't know about the service we offer that all people and that all people need a sticker, free and means-based cases, and need a sticker, and then in parenthesis or something, because it's not clear to me quite what how that free works there for somebody. And the last thing is very simple. We look forward to the improvements that our 2016 season will bring because we're already in it.
Well, this is written as if it were.
Yeah,
yeah.
This is,
but
this
we
is
got
a report.
July 2016, so that's the only reason I changed. Just that slight.
Yeah. It was hard to know where we were focusing.
Yeah, the whole tense thing is kind of, you know, which tense to shoot.
Well, you have to write it as though it's December 31st, 2015.
Right.
But this is a very comprehensive report, Alan. I mean,
That's really well done, Alan.
Yeah. Thank you so much
for
spending so much time.
Well, Susan expanded quite a bit, and Debbie did some more editing, so I just put it together. But yeah.
Group effort. Thank you.
Is there a motion to approve it with those numbers inserted?
So moved. Second.
All right. Any blocking concerns? Everybody in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, great. I got to leave. Okay. You're in charge.
Yes. So we still have a quorum. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 We still have a quorum. So Peter is, Peter, you, the tag sale is yours.
Oh, hang on a sec.
Okay, so how about the November rally? John, can you speak to the November rally? Yeah. Have you thought about that?
Yeah.
You, can we help in any way?
Not yet.
Okay.
It's becoming routine.
Yeah.
So the question about the dumpster going to the Eagles is the...
Yeah.
I tried to reach them. I haven't talked to them about
what
they would actually come and pick it up.
Okay.
But if Scotty's okay about taking it down there, I think... We'll do the paper again, the shredding. Bicycles seem, the guy seems to like be coming to that. Styrofoam.
Pumpkins.
Plastics. Oh, pumpkins. Oh, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Should we do
the pumpkin? Oh, that was real success.
Okay, excellent. So I encourage the concept of Gold Circuit Recycling being present because it would save city quite a bit of time and resources if they just brought their own dumpster and then took it away themselves.
Yeah.
So if that's something that can happen, you know, if he's going to prefer, if we're willing to do it, of course he's not going to want to do it, but he does it for other organizations, and I think that we certainly collect enough that it would be appropriate that he would come and bring in his own dumpster. And then we don't have to worry about, the only thing we would have to worry about is the placement of the bulky rigid plastic dumpster.
I think it's a giant trailer, isn't it?
That he brings, yeah.
Yeah.
So we would have to, he brings a...
Covered.
40, yeah. A huge trailer. So,
yeah.
So potentially. So I think that's very much worth pursuing.
Okay, I'll work on it.
Peter. Tag sale.
Mm-hmm.
We have, it's on October 1st with a rain date of October 8th.
And how about the publicity? Do you have a budget for it or not? Some ads. You did some ads last year.
Right. Well, we do the same thing every year. It's not, you know, whatever. We run various... Wait, did we run an ad?
Yeah.
I don't know that we ran an ad in the Gazette. We run...
I'm sure life, I think.
I will meet with you. I don't know that we...
But we get the freebie in Hampshire Life.
Yeah, we get the freebie in Hampshire Life. We get... I have to look and see what has been done in the past.
Also, I think it's Thursday in Living. If they get the press release in time, that it can be an event happening over the weekend. So there's a bunch of different places in the Gazette.
Mm-hmm.
That it can go for free.
Right.
Basically.
And because it's October 1st, that means then early September, we should send out the press release. So that's coming
not
up.
Not too early. About 10, well, 14 days. If it goes in two successive Hampshire Lives, but the ad for it shouldn't be too
early. Well,
what
I usually do is I send out a press release with all of the season's events, and then I follow it up with a press release about each event.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to give them time to know about it, and sometimes you can always follow it up with a second press release if there's something new and interesting.
I think there's two that we used
to
do.
This isn't worth taking committee time
to
talk about. So we will talk about that schedule, and any other costume. For instance, we talked about costume. We've had costume exchanges in the past. Is that something that we want to touch, or we just want to go ahead with our...
It's a full month before Halloween at that point.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, pumpkins are really good.
Yeah.
So I think that just might be a bit too...
Okay.
It's something that
can be done, or any other activity actually that we want to attach to the tag sale can be done, because we need to rent the bathrooms, basically, and therefore you have to, the cafeteria remains open. So anything like a table or something that we'd want to, any use that we'd want to make of that wouldn't cost
us. Can you use the cafeteria?
I believe so, yeah.
No, well.
With talking to Tim or Tom or.
Oh,
but it's a rain-free
it's a
event
free,
anyway.
Right.
So if we had a one-car stall that was a table of costume exchange, that could happen. I don't think a month is too early for people to be thinking
well,
about Halloween costumes.
Good, you know, it's a good event either way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, from the standpoint of maybe it could be wider. You know, clothes,
mm-hmm.
more clothes,
mm-hmm.
but clothes can get very messy very quickly.
Well, if there is a costume component. We need to have it organized.
And racks and things.
Right. And I have a rack. I think Debbie has a rack. But we have to have somebody that's willing to organize it.
Hmm.
So if nobody on the committee is willing to do that, we can check around to see if maybe some of the school clubs or something like that would be willing to do it. It's more. Because you also have to build awareness about the costume component, too.
Right,
so.
And not get it confusing, because a few people have been confused in the past about what is this event when they see a costume thing, and then it's also a tag sale, and they don't understand. And
mm-hmm.
So maybe it's easier just to not try to...
I love the
I know,
concept.
It's a good idea.
It's
yeah.
such a great idea, and one
year
we had an opera guild that gave us a whole bunch of costumes, and I mean, it's just such a great concept, but... it takes organization, and the payoff is not as great as we would like it to
be. It is pretty easy to get rid of, though. Like, they're all pretty much Salvation Army ready costume things, generally. So it's not like we get stuck with a lot of stuff.
It's an untapped
market,
right, that we just have to figure out if we want to continue tapping or not.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like there's not tons of enthusiasm about it. Is that correct?
I'm not willing to
we'll
head
confirm
it
that. Let's confirm that at the next meeting.
Which?
Okay. Yes. So we are. We're at 9:30. There is another. We haven't talked about the toy exchange. Peter would like to talk about the concept of having an auction at the toy exchange, and it needs to be. So can you guys stay another 5 or 10 minutes so that we can have that discussion? Okay.
Yes.
So I'm gonna quick do new business the next meeting, and then we can spend all of the time on the toy exchange. So anyone have new business? Anything new that has come up? Announcements to
me? Is at the Hosmer Gallery, interesting artist who I went to the reception of last night. She does, she's from Turner's. Nina's Nook is her, she has her own gallery up there. And there's a reuse place up there in Turner's that I want to go get familiar with.
Oh, the art garden?
No.
Oh, Turner's Falls.
Turner's.
Oh, that's Loot.
Loot, yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh. There is some kind of a retro fest that the Arts Council is promoting, and I thought it would be good for us to know what that is and maybe promote it if we can. It says retro vinyl, and I think it's like retro clothes and retro material, but it's reuse, so we might want to find out more about
promoting?
That. Northampton Arts Council. Our next meeting, if we follow our usual second Thursday of the month, would be September 8th, which is the week following Labor Day weekend. Is that, you're going to be alone?
I'm going all of September, so it doesn't matter.
Okay, okay. So should we just go ahead and shoot for that date?
Yeah.
Okay. So then Peter, Toy Exchange, that's on December 10th.
Right. And whether or not to, this is just planting the seed right now. As I mentioned earlier, there could be a new format that we look at, which would involve Green Northampton, which would act like I was on the committee of Friends of Western Mass Recycling when it opened back in the early 80s. The libraries have friends, half the library has friends of the library. And that could be primarily a fundraising entity of ours that we would use for instance, an auction. That would, rather than having the DPW being running an auction in any way, Green Northampton basically could do that. So after the toy exchange was over, we'd done at noon, during that time there would be a preview and some, and a, quite a, who would put it out, whether we would put it out, in other words, ReUse would put it out in conjunction with Green Northampton. But anyway, it would allow us to do a multiplier on our toy exchange by having some, and I have a large collection of toys, so if it went under Green Northampton, I could sell those and take a percentage of what that brings, which I'd be willing to give to our efforts, you know. And others could be enticed to put things into that auction. The idea is to collect some good stuff, but we really would need to start collecting stuff and getting this out real early in September. It takes a long, yeah, long time to germinate. People, oh yeah, yeah. So it really would require at the, well, nobody's going, you're not going to be here on 8th September, but it's a needed decision by then of whether we're interested in doing this or not.
So what Peter's proposing is a big change from what we've done in the past, not only because of the auction aspect, but because he's proposing a new entity getting involved and formed. I just want everybody to be really clear about what resources it would take to make something like this happen. So, as you know, the toy exchange is a big event that takes a lot of volunteers to run. The auction piece would add a whole nother layer to that, and so there are pros and cons of that. The pros are obviously that there would be some income, which we're not even sure what we would use. You know, we don't know why we would need income at this point.
Educational purposes would be the first, and a wood chipper
right.
would be the second.
Okay, but a wood chipper, I don't.
Yeah, I know, I know.
A wood chipper is a purchase that the city has to make, not this committee. But the resources that go into that, it means publicizing, it means generating, you know, finding the material, picking the material. Somebody would have to probably go through and pick things from the toys that were donated, which means then we need to make sure that everyone donating toys knows that this would happen, this might happen to their material. And we have to make that really clear. I don't think that we'd have to have them sign anything, but we have to be very clear about that to people. It's going to be a big effort to make this happen. And the question is, who is going to make that, who is going to do the work? And do we have somebody who's willing to take that on?
Well, I'm certainly willing to coordinate it. David, I think, also would be interested in doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see that the procedures would change that much. I don't expect that much would come in on a Friday night.
Well, it has to be advertised separately. I mean,
yes.
Not...
Yes. No. It's an additional event,
right,
to leverage, if you will, kind of word, on what we're doing with the toy exchange.
Mm-hmm.
That people know after that there's a real auction and some
mm-hmm.
real toys
mm-hmm.
coming up,
mm-hmm.
which hopefully would get advertised in some of the antiques publications.
Mm-hmm.
If it's worth, if we get that kind of stuff, it could be a very small auction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just because
mm-hmm.
we didn't get that much.
I'm a little confused because. To me, it seems like two very different events.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at two different clientele. I mean,
mm-hmm.
the people who come for the toy exchange are looking for free things because that's what they want.
Exactly.
I don't see them then sticking around to bid on items and raising any kind of money. I mean, maybe a little money, but
mm-hmm.
you're talking about a different class of people, a group of people who would want to come and buy things. And that's who you're looking to bring for an auction. I don't see the connection. I see the two different events.
Well, Donnie Rauscher is a local auctioneer who does at the Civic Center in Florence. So he would have, using him, we'd have his whole mailing list for a start. Plus, he's familiar
right.
with where.
So,
yes, it is
separate.
I think the point he's making is that it is a completely different event with a completely different target audience.
Yes.
And so, is that your...
Yeah,
okay,
so I'm not sure why we would do it on the same day, at the same time.
My concern is, again, volunteer effort. I'm happy to help, but I will say last year, you know, I was there Friday night and I was there Saturday morning. I was pretty exhausted by
then,
you know.
It's a lot.
And for all of us to chip in and do that, then to stay for another how many extra hours.
Yeah.
Plus, you know, part of what's going to be asked is helping to move all that stuff in for display and out or whatever. I think it's too much for one day.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's a great idea, Peter. I think it's something we probably should do on a separate
discussion.
On a separate day.
A separate day. I think it's a separate event.
Yeah, why not? Why not have it a separate day?
Well, again, I go back to the leverage part because there's toys. I see having, you know, where we had the raffle, there'd be a preview so that anybody who did come that day only could see, oh, at noon, this stuff's getting sold.
But where would we put all that stuff? You know,
it'd be
the
stage.
Well,
stage.
So
we used the stage last year for the raffle.
For the raffle, right. Well, do we have the raffle then if we're going to have the,
We had talked about having an auction at some point as one of our potential fundraising opportunities. This would also mean that if we had an auction, it would be for toys only, which is something that limits what the reuse committee had in its vision of an auction, because we had talked about having an auction that would, or some kind of a silent auction, you know, of a fundraiser that we could put anything in, not just toys. So it's also a little limiting potentially in that respect. It's a huge opportunity because at that time of year, people are buying things. Although, if they're antique-y type things, it's not necessarily somebody buying it for Joey, for little Joey. It might draw different antique dealers and stuff like
it's
that.
It's rarely for little Joey.
Yeah. So there's really no need for it to be in December even. So one question is. Is a special toy auction something that this committee is interested in supporting? And the second is, if so, when would it be? And are we willing to give the resources required to make that happen?
And you don't have to answer now, really, because not to.
Well, in general, I would, after what I said before, vote for a different time, and I don't think it should be just. If you're going to all the trouble of having an auction, it probably shouldn't be just a toy auction. I think it would be better to be.
The reason it does make some sense for me is that it brings a specific client to a specific sale. If you have a general sale, as I've gone to a lot in the valley lately, and stuff's bringing nothing. I mean, you know, put two modern chests of drawers. For $10 and you can't get a bid for the both. You know? So what we would have generally is thinking, oh, this is going out to auction, you know, it might not do very well. I mean, frankly, it might not be worth that expense. But if you can advertise starting in September, I believe, anyway, that there will be a specific toy auction that then toy buyers, even if there's 10, 20 in the valley, but it brings in the immediate area, but it brings other people because it's properly advertised. That's the advantage.
So, Peter, you needed to know now whether this was a go.
No, it's September. This, you know, it's a lot, and as I say, it can be done as a friends of,
right.
Which would mean to rustle up some other antique people who. Know how to do running. That's how I started as a runner in that auction.
So, Peter, can you make a motion as to whether this committee would support a toy auction in December of this year, and we can vote on it, or are you wanting to do that in September?
Well, although we can get affidavits or whatever from John. And Alan, I'd rather actually wait till, you know, people are gone already.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
Let's let this, I'd like to let it germinate,
mm-hmm.
you know, and think about it. And how,
mm-hmm.
if you were going to run an auction, or, you know, you were, how would, you know, what would you want? How would you go about it? Who, how would you get at people? The key is getting enough people
mm-hmm.
to come.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not promoted on that score,
mm-hmm.
stuff can, as I put some stuff into a New Hampshire auction.
And who is going to be doing the promotion?
The promotion, I'm familiar with where the ads need to go.
No,
ads.
Who would be coordinating all the promotion?
Well, if it's on a different, other than the toy exchange, if it's on a different day,
mm-hmm.
that is actually a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think Sundays are good.
But who is going to be doing the promotion of this event?
Right.
This committee or?
It's,
well, if the auction is under the auspices of Green Northampton, by the way, everybody can join Green, you know, all you do is get on the mailing list and you're a member of Green Northampton at this point. So you can wear both hats, no problem. But if it's under the auspices of Green Northampton, then I would be scurrying around for instance, Donnie Rausch's advertising schedule. Yeah, it would take about, you know, $1,000 in ads, at least $1,500 in ads.
So let's table this discussion until next month.
Just a comment. I mean, listening to what you've said, it's a good idea. If there are toys from the toy exchange that you think might fit that category,
mm.
to just remove them from that, and getting permission from the people who donate them, and have it in January. If it doesn't sound like they're Christmas presents anyway, you're talking about antiques or something that people are going to buy.
Collectibles. Yeah.
Do it in January when we don't have any other events.
Yeah.
And then you might get more volunteers to help out, just as a thought, to push it off and not do it during December.
Yeah, actually, you know, these kind of toy sales happen just all through the year.
Well, right, that's
you know,
what I'm
not
hearing.
Not specific
just as
to,
a thought. Okay.
Yeah. But that's pretty much it.
Okay. Anything else? Thank you, everybody, for staying late. I appreciate it.